listen to music?
Yeah, I do, some. I mean, I'm not sure that I'm really... Contemporary music, I don't really know as much unless my kids.
Okay.
I mean, I know who Beyonce is, but I mean...
Yep. Well, I'm sure Beyonce knows who you are now. Sure.
Well,
you
know, I doubt it, but it's true. Yeah.
She might.
She might.
Did they have a Beyonce mass at Grace Cathedral? I still don't know exactly what they did, but they said 1,000 people came.
Oh, my goodness.
Which, well, okay. Whatever it takes to get folk in church, that's fine with me.
Yeah, well.
I don't know. I don't know exactly what they did. I don't know enough about her music to really know what the lyrics are talking about.
Yeah.
I mean,
Lady Gaga is an Episcopalian.
You know, I did know that.
Yeah.
I did know that. Yeah,
it might be a little more difficult to do a Lady Gaga Eucharist, though. I mean, you know.
Yeah, I'd probably just let Lady Gaga come and get her own meeting. Yeah, I'm trying to remember where she was performing. And she went to 8 o'clock Mass, wherever she was. It was in Texas somewhere.
I think so. Maybe.
Yeah.
Maybe it was that before the Super Bowl.
Yes, that is
a halftime show.
That was it. Yep. And she was in there. She went to 8 o'clock.
I think we should test your knowledge of music, though.
Oh, that'd be fine.
Let's
sure.
See. Let's
it won't
see
won't take
can.
A lot. It'd be pretty easy.
Yeah. Well, let's see if we can test you out here. See if you, how long it takes you to get this.
Uh-huh. Oh, can I see the music? Man?
You gotta know this one. And all these are about love, by the way. So,
oh, they are about love.
Yeah. You know.
That's Earth, Wind, and Fire. You can tell by the music.
Do you remember? It's Earth, Wind, and Fire.
Oh, it's Earth, Wind.
Okay, come on.
Yeah, everybody knows that.
Okay, so if we go old school.
Uh-huh. That's right. Everybody knows Ray.
Now this is going to really push the limits here. Let's see.
I shouldn't cheat. Look.
No, don't look. Don't look. You got to keep it on the up and up here. You know, you'll impress a lot of teenagers and 20-year-olds if you know this.
If I know this?
Yeah. Oh. I mean, you'll definitely impress a lot of people. Maybe you should cheat.
I probably need to cheat.
This is Kendrick Lamar.
Oh, Lamar. Yeah. Oh, yeah.
And you know...
I know who he is.
Yeah. Well, you know he won the Pulitzer.
He won the Pulitzer.
Prize.
I know it.
You know, a lot of people
in the
classical world just got upset about that.
It's poetry.
It is poetry.
It's
and it's truth.
It's truth. It's poetry. It's prophecy.
It is prophecy.
It can get edgy and, you know...
Oh, yeah.
I'm sorry.
Oh, he pushes it.
Even the biblical prophets in their time were edgy.
You know, I'm not sure anybody's called Kendrick a biblical prophet yet.
I didn't go that far, but I'm just saying.
Well,
but I mean, he really is a poet.
He is a poet.
I was in Jerusalem. Well, in Jerusalem, but I went to see one of the schools, one Episcopal schools there, run by the diocese, and we have a young adult service corps. Volunteer.
Is that associated with like St. George's at all, or?
Well, it's the same diocese. I mean, okay. it's a diocese, but the schools. I think we were in Nazareth, I think.
Okay.
We've got a youth volunteer from here, from the state, who's there, and he's working with. They're working on leadership development and nonviolent training skills, conflict resolution, with kids who are Palestinian, Israeli. Jewish, Muslim,
wow.
Christian.
That's the work.
And these are teenagers that they're working
with.
But, I mean, they're really doing some stuff. They've been doing this for a number of years, but really are doing... Anyway, one of them had done some rap. And what the other kid said was, he's a real poet. That's how they described him.
Yes.
As a poet. We're talking poetry.
We are talking poetry.
Yeah. No question.
And, you know, poetry always tells us more truth than we want to hear.
Right.
You think some of those teenagers could come back and run for Congress? I mean, that would be nice.
It would be nice. It would be nice. Yeah.
It'd be great.
Yeah, let them take over. They probably could fix some stuff.
You know, I'm wondering, how on earth are you taking care of yourself these days? I mean, because
You travel all the time. Do you get breaks?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Good. Yeah.
Just don't tell anybody about
breaks. Don't tell me I'm breaking. Nobody knows. So, yeah. Well, no, because what I do is, I mean, I'll be gone. I'll be gone for a stretch. And then I'll go home on the Raleigh and be there and rest. And sometimes I'll do it in New York, but get a day or two, especially international. I just have to have, I've got to recalibrate the internal clock.
Absolutely.
And so you just take that and just do light office kind of stuff, not heavy duty stuff.
Light. I'm sure it's light for the presiding bishop.
Well, imagine by the time it makes it to your desk, it's actually not very light.
It's probably not, yeah. There's a lot of truth in that.
I imagine most of those files are pretty heavy.
Yeah, they're busy. They're busy.
They are.
They're busy. But you pay if you pace it. And I'm blessed with a remarkable staff of people. I really
are.
And so the way we do scheduling really does build in rest time.
Good.
You know, I'm a high energy. I can go for a while, but
you're high energy.
I'm getting older, so I'm slowing up somewhat. But
I don't see it.
You didn't want to be around me at 25. Now 65. I'm mellow.
All right.
Oh yeah.
I remember the first time I heard you preach, Bishop.
Where were you?
In Chicago, and this was like in 2002 maybe. And it was a conference in the winter.
It was on children.
It was on children.
Remember, we got snowed in.
Yes, and you stood up and said, I have had the flu. I'm not myself today.
I did it.
You remember that?
I ended up staying in the room an extra day because I had a flu.
And then you said, so I'm not going to preach very well. And about 25 minutes later, I thought, good granny, if this guy... The flu. You know, what's he like when he doesn't have a fever?
That's right. Yeah, I remember staying at that hotel like a day or two after the conference. I just couldn't get on the plane.
It was 4 degrees. I remember that. It was 4 degrees one day.
And remember, the flu went around. A lot of people at that conference got sick.
It did. That's been a while ago.
That was Chicago. You were right.
Wow. Well, you know, way back then, did you ever think that the Archbishop of Canterbury would call you up and say, we got a couple over here. They want to get married.
They want to get married.
You want to come preach?
Yeah, I saw it in a dream earlier on.
Did you?
No, that was not my even. In fact, the Archbishop's boy's office, because he was calling on behalf of the couple, and they called his office called and got Chuck Robertson from my staff. I don't know where I was, but anyway, so Chuck eventually got me. I didn't believe him. I thought it was a spoof. I thought they were like, you know, I thought this was a setup and they were taping it and
right.
It was a joke. So I didn't take it. So I said, Chuck, what do you really want? I mean, cut the nonsense.
Right.
And he had to convince me that this was for real.
That's awesome.
And then I said, oh my God. I mean, I knew the wedding was going to happen.
Right.
Like everybody else, but I hadn't even thought about it. No.
Wow. So, what was it really like? I mean, to walk into that kind of, I mean, we all watch it on television, and I've been to London and I've seen these places. I mean, they're magnificent.
They really are magnificent, just incredible.
But what's it like to be on the inside of all that, and to, I mean, is it just like going to church, or was it pretty much?
Some differences in that there was, you know, obviously there's a lot of security.
Right.
A lot of security.
I imagine.
Very well hidden. I mean, you didn't see. I don't think so on TV. And we didn't really see. You could see it if you stopped and paid attention. You say, okay, that dude's standing there. He got a thing in his ear.
Sure.
Oh, and that one has a big gun.
Sure.
Okay.
I got it.
Yeah. I mean, so it gets obvious. But, I mean, they were very discreet but clearly present. I mean, they knew what they were doing. And there had been pre-screening of everyone who was in that church.
Oh, I'm sure.
And everybody who was actually in the precincts of Windsor. Of the castle, of the complex. So there had been preliminary. So that was different. But not any different than if you've gone to something where the president's going to be or something like that.
Right.
I mean, that was similar. But actually, if you've been in an Episcopal church, it was a wedding.
Yeah.
It was a church wedding. Now, I mean, obviously,
it's a little fancier than
but
most.
There were a little bad. But basically, you had two families, you had guests, and you had a church service.
Oh,
so once the service began, I was in church. I was in,
yes.
Yeah,
yes.
I was in church. There's like any priest in a church marrying a couple.
Well, you know.
I was giving the homily. The archbishop was officiating.
I loved how you sort of started out slow and predictable, and then you just turned it on. I thought that was a really, you know, you eased into it.
Mm.
If you know what I mean.
Yeah.
You know, I mean,
sure.
I just loved every second that you were speaking, and I think the world loved every second that you're speaking, and I think that's just been so evident.
Man, that's God stuff. Believe
yeah,
me,
it
that,
is.
That I really am. I'm just very aware. This is God. That's God trying to get our attention.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that the reason that it works though is because you let it be God stuff and not you stuff.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
I mean, I
really didn't want me to get in the way.
Yeah.
I really didn't.
Well, you didn't get in the way.
That's been a prayer. Thank you. Thank you, brother. That's been my prayer most of the ministry. Okay, Lord, please get me out of the way. I mean, really, get me out of the way.
Yeah, that's
so you
a good
can do
one.
Your thing.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Well, it was splendid. And
then
you
didn't want to do anything to embarrass it.
Oh, you didn't embarrass us.
I know, but you don't
want to. You put us on the map.
Make sure I was aware there were cameras every time. So
sure.
All of a sudden, my nose starts itching. My nose never itches. Like, no.
It's like all those pictures
right
of the queen
service.
When she scratches her nose and they take it from the other side.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
It looks like, oh, my gosh. Royals don't do that, you know. Right. So
when your nose itches and you just simply do like this.
Mm, yes, a thought.
And so you're listening in thought. Yeah, like the thinker.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
And then you can scratch the nose.
You're sitting there. Did you have a sense that Harry and Meghan were actually trying to make all the statements that they made? Or do you think that it was somewhat just the culmination of decisions that then, you know, I mean, because think about it. She walks down the aisle by herself.
Mm-hmm.
She makes a feminist statement, I think, in that. That whole thing with her mother arriving and, you know, that she's an American. There's the issues of race and everything that's going on. And then you're in powerful sermon and then the prayers of the people from multiple voices and multiple perspectives. And, you know, it was a very powerful moment. And it, I think part of the reason that people turned their head was that they didn't expect the royal family to do this, you know. Did you, in the midst of that liturgy, do you have a sense of the sort of the gravitas of it all, or did it just seem like it was all happening and was, you know,
both? I mean, I was aware of the gravitas of it and was very aware. I mean, I think it was I think the liturgy and the experience was, I think it was genuinely reflective of the two of them as
right.
people and what they believe and care about, and
right.
also the families and worlds that they come from. I mean,
yeah.
I think it really did reflect all of that. They designed much of that. I mean, that was, you know, for example, even something as basic as the liturgy itself, part of it was out of the 1662
official prayer book. Yeah.
The balance of it was from the Common Worship,
right.
From the contemporary or present worship books of the Church of England. And they brought sort of the best of both together, which is perfectly kosher. I mean,
absolutely.
That was their decision to do that in consultation with the Archbishop and
right.
the Dean of the chapel. That was their decision. They made a decision to invite me. That was their decision. I mean, they had approvals, I'm sure all
sure.
around. But they, the young cellist, the 19-year-old.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my God.
Amazing.
He was 19 years old.
I took
his picture. We took a picture before he got, you know, got dressed up. We were at Lambeth Palace getting ready to leave. We took a picture.
An extraordinary talent.
He is
just absolutely gorgeous.
There he is. That was right before.
Oh, that's awesome.
You see?
That's awesome.
It was right before we left. I mean, he's a musical genius.
He is.
And he's just a humble, just a nice young guy.
Yeah, that's awesome.
He's 19 years old, and he was playing with some of the finest musicians in the world.
In the world.
And he commanded.
Now, how did they find him?
And he commanded. Well, I know he had been in a musical.
That's right.
Contest isn't the right word.
Yep.
It was a musical. He won a musical. I want to say it was a BBC
okay.
musical or something. It was something really significant where they identify real significant talent. And, you know, I mean, I just being there, I said, oh, now, you know, in the Bible, Elijah drops the mantle, passes the mantle on to Elijah, yeah. Elisha. And I said, oh, this is where Yo-Yo Ma's mantle is.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
I mean, I could hear it. It's just extraordinary.
It is.
But, you know, that was an accident. I believe the Duchess, Megan, asked for him specifically. I mean, there were, so the two of them really did design that greatly, but they were reflecting who they actually are. They weren't, yeah. that was them, and it was their families. I mean, they brought mm-hmm. their worlds together.
They
and
did bring their worlds together.
Worlds. And that was, beautiful. I think that's why it was beautiful. And the spirit worked with that.
That's true.
You know, that's...
Well, you bring people together, and the spirit's always going to work.
Spirit's going to show
up.
Yeah.
You know, the spirit's going to show up.
Yeah, the spirit can work with you when you're real.
Right. That, well.
Yeah. You know, you're doing an act. Oh, yeah. The show's all about you.
That's right. That's exactly
they were,
right. Well, it felt authentic. I mean,
the people who were there in the congregation, I mean, outside of the families, afterward, I got to talk to a number of them. I mean, these were people who were friends of theirs and associates and people who were doing work in various foundations and charities
right.
and organizations that reflect the values that they have about improving the human family
right.
and taking care of the creation. I mean, and so afterward, I got to talk to a number of them. I mean, that was deliberate. That was by design. They were there. They brought their worlds together, and by doing that, brought the world together.
Yes.
Even just for a few moments.
Well, Harry's always, I think, sort of lived into the spirit of his mother
yeah.
In that kind of philanthropic
oh, yeah.
way and stewardship of
yeah.
of his time. So, you know, I think that it was authentic and it mm-hmm. came across that way.
Mm-hmm. They both are people of values who actually believe in values that have to do with, you know, like Jesus said, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the
right.
Sabbath.
That's right.
I mean, it's obvious. And people saw that.
Yes. Well, you know, speaking of the spirit, it's awesome when you can get SNL to mention the spirit. You know, it's... What was that like for you?
Yeah, I mean, pretty cool.
Did they notify you they were going to do that,
yeah.
or you just found
no,
out?
They just do what they do. It was the truth. I didn't even know it. After the wedding, there was a reception, and so we went with the reception for a little while. I mean, there was a party later that
right.
night. We weren't at the party that night, so we went to the reception, which was immediately after the wedding, and. It was very nice. It was a wedding reception, like
right.
wedding receptions you've been to.
Right.
It just happened to be royal family walking around the room. And
that's
Hollywood
awesome.
People. And, you know, but it was a wedding reception. So after that, I left, and my wife went back to London. And I went with the Archbishop and his wife to went to St. Albans Cathedral.
Okay.
For, you know, as the Archbishop has been leading a campaign, a prayer campaign between Pentecost and, I mean, between Pentecost Day and, I don't know, between Pentecost and Ascension.
Ascension or what?
Between, I've forgotten now, but anyways, in the Pentecost, at the beginning of the Pentecost
okay.
season. And it's called Thy Kingdom Come. And he's been, and we've been participating in that. And they had 1,000 young people in St. Albans Cathedral. That's
oh, wow.
an old medieval cathedral, but 1,000 young people for a youth crusade, youth rally, or whatever the right word
right,
right.
were,
youth revival, whatever. And it was just wonderful. So we left the wedding and went to that. We'd gone to another church service. So I wasn't, we did a press conference there on the grounds of St. Albans. But I hadn't seen any media. I hadn't seen any social media. So I didn't know what was going on.
You didn't know you
no.
were the most tweeted moment of the royal
family. I missed that.
No, I didn't. No. You missed that.
I didn't even know that until just now. But apparently,
oh, yeah.
yeah, that yeah. all was, I was, I went to, did my job at another press conference and did interviews. And then we went in the church and we were with the kids until, I don't know, like 8 or 9 that night. And got back to London about 10:30. But by the time I got back, my wife was still up, but we had to get up at 5. To catch flights back to the States. And so I went to sleep. And really,
yeah,
sacked out. I was
I'm
gone
sure.
by that time.
I'm sure you were tired.
And got up at 5, got to Heathrow, and got on the plane and did all the stuff you do. and went and was sitting in one of the lounge, in the American Airlines lounge, and was sitting in there and realized I was taking selfies with people. A lot of people. And I knew it was happening in Heathrow, and so the people in the lounge, the managers, I took with the whole staff in the lounge.
Oh, that's awesome.
I took a selfie with the staff in the lounge. And so they said, do you mind if we do the VIP protocol for you? And I said, well, now if I was in the hospital, I would be afraid, because I would assume that means I was getting a shot. I said, but what does this mean? And they had this way. They said, because you're not going to get to your plane if you're going to get stopped all the way.
Oh, yeah, sure, all the way.
If we don't, I said, well, okay, you've obviously done this before, so I'll do whatever it is. And I couldn't believe going through Heathrow.
How many people?
Yeah, I had no idea that this was going on. And then getting on the plane, took pictures with the flight attendants and the whole crew.
Awesome.
Took pictures. They waited until everybody else was asleep, and then we went back and snuck and took the picture. The pilot kept flying, but we took the picture. And I still didn't know about Saturday Night Live. I didn't, because this would have been Sunday.
Right. Time.
So it had been after the Saturday Night Live thing. I didn't know about that till Monday.
Okay.
And then I saw it later.
How on earth do you think that they were so nimble that they turned that around? But they had your vestments right. That's what got me.
Well,
how do you run out to a place and find
vestments? I'm convinced there's some Episcopal bishop, Dave, and I'm just talking.
You're gonna find out.
I say the bishops of Long Island or New York or somewhere in New Jersey. Want somebody? No, they got wardrobe people who are.
Oh yeah.
These are artists. They got the Ratchet Shamir down.
They did.
And then they got the caricature. It was brilliant.
It was fun.
It showed how talented they are. They had less than 5 hours.
Right.
To pull that off. And pulled it off. And, you know, and did their riff and did their character. It was a stitch. It was brilliant.
I think they should invite you to do, like, the opening one week.
Yeah, I thought that'd be a great thrill for anybody, but nonetheless, it's a nice idea.
Well, it'd be for me. I mean, I would love it. Think about all the Episcopalians that are tuning into SNL. I mean, actually, yeah. I bet there's a high percentage of Episcopalians that tune into SNL pretty regularly.
Or at least if you like me, I watch it the next day.
Yeah, I'll catch it,
you know, at the YouTube ones. Yeah, because usually it's Saturday night.
Oh, I think there are a lot of priests that are finishing their sermons while they watch SNL.
Please don't tell me that. That's painful to contemplate. But it's possible, yeah.
Well, you know, the good thing about that, everything about that, was that the message was so heartfelt and so authentic and so what the world needs to hear right now about love. And then you had the opportunity because of that to come back and speak on some morning shows and different things. And you know, isn't it nice that something like the royal wedding can draw attention to the authenticity of good news and goodness in people?
Yeah.
Because there's just so much bad stuff right now out there that, you know, people are lonely, they're lost, they don't know what's going on, they don't have purpose, everything seems divided in our culture.
Yeah.
And there you are talking about love, and people just reach onto it because that's what they're sort of craving, is to be loved. Know that they're okay the way God created them to be.
That is the message of Jesus.
Yeah.
That, I mean, you know, it's like the Bible, God so loved the world that he gave his only. I mean, it wasn't because it was ticked off with it.
Right.
It wasn't because, you know what I mean? Think about it. God loved this world, and that in us, and does, and love seeks the best, the highest, and the greatest good. This is not just schmaltzy stuff.
Yeah.
This is about transforming us to become who we are meant to be in the first place.
Absolutely.
That's what that is. And for that message to be received and actually heard and wanted, that had nothing to do with Michael Curry. That is clearly the Spirit of God meeting the spirit of the age and saying, here's a message for your time.
Wow.
Here's a message. That's just clear. Because if it wasn't, it wouldn't have clicked.
I appreciate your humility, but it also is an indication that Michael Curry knows that Michael Curry is loved. You know, you can't just say those things.
No.
As concepts. You know, I think that's part of the challenge. We have to speak authentically from
right.
the we've been carried, and boy, you did that.
And I've learned that in this church.
Oh, yeah.
In this church, it really did. I mean, I was blessed to...
You grew up in the Episcopal Church.
I grew up, and I mean, I was an interesting fusion. You know, like you have fusion food and that kind of stuff. My dad was a priest, and, you know, so I grew up with a Beretta-wearing priest and all that.
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, Lord, yeah. And, but my grandma was dying of Rock Ridge Baptist.
Okay. And you got the best of both worlds.
So summers at grandma's church and vacation Bible school there, you're kind of in, and in the winters, we were incense and holy water and bells. And,
oh, yeah.
You know, I mean, it was just, so, but it was, that was a blessing. I mean, at the time, and nobody was thinking about it then.
Right.
But to have grown up in that environment where it was the faith that mattered, how that got expressed, there are a variety of gifts of the same spirit. St. Paul was right about that, you know?
Right.
And so I grew up with that. And with people who, you know, now that I look back on it, had an understanding of the faith that was actually, I mean, not to be cliche, but loving and liberating and life-giving. I didn't grow up with a negative.
No, just slapping you.
And so that was, I know that that's not everybody's journey, but that was mine. But I think somehow they got a handle on some of the core of the faith of Jesus, if you will, that's easy to miss, or that often doesn't get conveyed, and that gets conveyed in ways that are not loving. That's why a lot of people turn away from Christianity. It's not that they're bad people, or sometimes the presentation of Christianity has not engendered life.
That's right.
And so I was fortunate to have grown up in a context where people, and in a context where folk believed that the teachings of Jesus and the gospel actually has impact for our lives personally, but on our social lives together.
Absolutely.
In society. It wasn't just an individual. It was an individual faith, but it was also social faith.
Right.
And it had to do with how we treat others applies not just to my relationship with you, but it has to do with our relationship as a society with each other, with the poor, and with people who don't have as much.
Yes.
That's the same gospel.
It is.
Same. And that sermon was not Michael Curry. I pray it was Jesus. Learned in a variety of worlds, from growing up in this church, growing up in the womb of the old Black Baptist church tradition, growing up in a family that believed the gospel, but did it and laughed, and it wasn't, somebody said it wasn't like a bunch of Debbie Downers at a convention. I mean, it's just the way it was.
It was the way, yeah.
And life was tough for them. I mean, you know, I mean, my life doesn't that tough, but for a lot of the folk that I learned the faith from,
right? Oh yeah,
their lives were hard.
Right.
I mean, my grandmother's life. I mean, just a sharecropper's daughter, a granddaughter slave. I mean, her life was not an easy. My life's been nothing compared to hers, and yet she was a joyful Christian to the day she died. Who's interesting? I mean, again, she was in another world, another era. But I don't think there was an exclusivistic bone in her body.
Wow.
Now, that's, you know, amazing. You think, where does that come from?
Yeah, where does that come from?
I don't know. I just know that's the way she was.
We're back to that spirit.
That's the spirit. That is.
We're at the airport, and I don't want to be at the airport. I'd rather keep talking.
We sure are at the airport.
We're here.